the night before she passed away. I said, "Are you worried about me?" And she said, "No." I said, "Don't. Even if you start to worry a little bit, because you've left me a very rich woman, because I have your spirit. I have what you have, and no one is more wealthy than I am because of you."
Welcome to Mamas in Spirit, a podcast pointing you towards God in everything you are and everything you do. I'm Lindy Nguyen, and I'm blessed to be here with you. And I am also blessed to be here with Shelia Claverie. And if only you could see her doing her dance hands across from me, you would see what a joyful, wonderful soul for the Lord that she is. Shelia, thank you so much for being here.
Oh, I'm happy to be here, Lindy. Actually, you, me, joy, and the Holy Spirit. Well, the Holy Spirit is first.
Yes, and when she's talking about joy, she's talking about my dog. However, the joy is also here because Shelia's here and the Holy Spirit's here.
Thank you very much.
And we are exploring Advent, this time of waiting and waiting in joyful hope, which is a perfect topic for Shelia. Yes. And I know that you are just going to bless us abundantly. So before you share about you, let us begin in prayer. Dearest Lord, thank you for gifting us with a gift of joy. And sometimes it can be so hard for us to wait, Lord, to wait in life for really anything. Waiting can be filled with anxiety. It can be filled with fear or trepidation. Yet it can also be filled with your holy hope. And that's what you call us to. You call us to wait ultimately for you, yet also for everything in our lives, for your holy plan to unfold with joyful hope. So we pray for this time of Advent, Lord. We pray that we think of Mary carrying Jesus and the manger and this time of precious waiting for the coming of the Savior of the world. In your name we pray. Amen. Amen. Shelia, I'm blessed to know you. Could you please share some about you with our listeners?
I'm from New Orleans. I grew up in New Orleans, and I was educated in New Orleans. And my husband and I moved here when I was 29, and I had two children and a dog. And I left. We drove across country, and all four of us were in the front, and the dog, the German Shepherd, was stretched out on the back seat. So it was a fun trip because what I told my children to get them to leave their friends was we were going to Disneyland and we have to hurry because we're going to Disneyland.
Did you take your children to Disneyland when you got here?
Several times.
That wasn't an empty promise, was it?
No, several times.
I love how you brought that image already and that road trip to move your life from New Orleans to California, because we're on a pilgrimage and you are taking your children to the next step of your pilgrimage as a family.
Right.
And you created a hope-filled environment. And while you were doing that in a childlike way for your children, that's the kind of hope that we're called to live in. And our pilgrimages, our journeys, our roads are filled with all kinds of highs, consolation, closeness with God, and lows, difficult times, struggles, things that we grapple with.
Yes.
So Shelia, I would love if you could share with our listeners how you have lived in joyful hope and learned to live in joyful hope regardless of the circumstances unfolding in your life.
Well, two of my children weren't born here in California. The last one was. And when one was 14 and the other was 11, I find myself having a third child at 35. And of course, I'm happy, but you start counting as a mother. Okay, I'm going to have one in high school. Oh, that means I'm going to have one in college. And so when I go to the doctor, he said, "Well, you're 35, you can have an amniocentesis." And I said, "Well, I don't want that." He said, "Well, you'll find out if the baby's Down syndrome." And I said, "That doesn't matter. God has gifted me with this child, and I'm going to have a third child." And he said, "Well, you'll find out what the sex is." This was long before ultrasound. And I said, well, I don't really want to know what the sex is. It doesn't matter. I'm going to have a third child. So about 8 months, I started feeling pain. And I go to the emergency and I said, I'm in labor. No, you're not. The nurse says, no, you're not. I said, well, I'm not leaving. Because in my experience, when I go into labor, my children get trapped in the birth canal. And I'm not leaving. So what do? They call the doctor in, and the doctor said, it's a good thing you waited because you are in labor and we're going to take the baby tonight. One of the most joyful times that I've ever had, well, three of the most joyful times that I've ever had is having my three children. I can't describe the peace. I can't describe the joy. The whole world is outside. It's just us. And my blood pressure would always elevate, and the doctors couldn't figure it out. I was so excited that God has gifted me with this child.
Yes, I love how you communicate without really using the specific word about the sacredness of waiting and the birth of your own children and that peace, that unmatched peace and connection and depth that you felt in your attachment and love and closeness with them. And it's so beautiful of an image.
What a privilege it is for us to have children. What a privilege. You look down at the baby and you said, God has entrusted one of his creations to us to raise and to bring them to God's glory. He's entrusted us. Now, because I'm older, I think I should have said, God, you sure you want me? Because I don't know this. I don't know that. I don't know everything. And he walks with you. He walks with you through the lives of your children.
I love how you talk about our children being entrusted to us. A part of the waiting and joyful hope is God entrusting us as God's disciples to share Christ and to share true love with the world.
And we have to trust. I'm sure that Mary and Joseph, they had to trust God. They had to leave their home. They had to go to the next town because they followed the law. And the time for Mary had come for her to have the baby. God knew that the bread of life was going to be in a feeding trough for animals. He knew. And it's so sacred. It's God's time with us when we wait, when we anxiously wait. Because you realize when we do wait, we're more in prayer than we've ever been. When we wait and we have situations where, for example, with the baby, I said, I'm not leaving. And I was in prayer because I didn't want anything to happen. I didn't want to carry a baby 8 months and then not have it born, lose it. So I was in prayer all the time.
Yes. And I love how you talk about how we are often so much more attentive to our prayer life and walking in prayer during times of waiting.
During times of waiting, we are really prayerful. We're more prayerful than so-called normal times. We're more prayerful when we're waiting.
Yes. And it really does prune us and sharpen us.
Exactly.
Towards the Lord, even when it's really difficult or ambiguous for us. And I remember waiting for our littlest and the weeks up to her birth, and she's adopted, and knowing that this was the deepest desire of my heart. This was the thing that I most longed for. And in such a vulnerable way and almost an inexplicable way. And I remember praying. And like you said, it was almost like constantly sitting in prayer, because if someone can imagine the deepest desire of your heart being dangled in front of you per se, and knowing that it could be lost or dropped or not happen at any moment. And I remember waking up in the middle of the night and praying and gripping a medallion that a dear friend had given me. And I remember praying the rosary and just praying all the time. Just praying all the time. And then I remember this dream coming to fruition.
Wow.
And going to church on Christmas, and someone having no idea that I was going to be having this baby, adopting this baby. Almost no one knew. We didn't even barely know that this was going to happen. It was 3.5 weeks before she was born that we got a phone call. Wow. And she said that she saw me carrying this baby and I was glowing. And that's the hope coming to fruition.
Yeah.
That is the joy, the goodness. That's the joy of Christmas.
That is the joy of Christmas. And actually, every single time, in fact, I was pregnant, I glowed because I knew there was something good that was going to happen at the end of the period.
And is there a time in your life where you really relate to the difficulty of Mary's journey and the challenges leading up to the birth of Jesus? Her time of Advent, per se, was tumultuous.
Right.
And filled with threat, even yeah. on her life and the life of her baby.
My oldest son, my mother wasn't with me. My son is 51. During that time, the fathers weren't able to go into the rooms when the baby was born. So I was in there all alone. But I trusted God because I said, God, you wouldn't have taken me this far and not there be some joy at the end of this journey. I just trusted God and I knew. Never ever did I doubt, and he got me through it in another state, in another climate, going to Maine. It's a whole different climate, not knowing anyone. And God provided friends. I even had a baby shower and I only knew these people like 3 or 4 months. They were so giving. God provides. He just provides if you trust. So I'm sure that's what Mary had when she was going. She probably said to herself, or maybe even discussed it with Joseph, God wouldn't have put me on this path if he didn't know that there was a light at the end of the tunnel. He wouldn't have done that. She trusted God. Once she said yes, she said yes because she knew God, and she knew God wouldn't put her on that path without giving her joy and gladness at the end of her journey. And her journey didn't end with the baby. It just started. And all along, I know Mary trusted God through her journey with Jesus at home, through her journey with Jesus when he started his public life. I know she trusted that God would be with her on that journey.
I so appreciate how you talk about both instinct and trust, because in regards to instinct, I remember, even like you're saying, when being blessed with our little one as a baby, I would think about all the women who have had babies before and who have had children before. And clearly it is deeply interwoven into our beings how to care for a vulnerable infant and baby. Also, when you talk about that trust and Mary's trust, she's the ultimate example. She is the example of caring for a baby in very difficult circumstances and complete reliance on God and intimacy in her relationship with God. And that example is a pathway for us. It's a roadmap for us.
Her example is the pathway that we should all take. I can't imagine the pain that she went through seeing her son go through the things that we know he did go through at the end of his life. And a son that she didn't know from day to day what was going to happen. Whatever we have to go through that's constant in our life, Mary went through it too. But she went through it with joy and gladness, knowing that this was what God wanted her to do.
So Shelia, you are a person that emanates joy and gladness. Can you share with our listeners, where does that come from in you?
I have a very deep and sincere prayer life. Prayer is important to me. That's one thing. I genuinely love people. I try most of the time to see God in everyone, even in every creation, even in joy, I try to see, and I do see, and if they're having a bad day, if they don't respond to my joy, then I pray for them, because it's so much better to be joyful than it is to be sad or angry or whatever else they're going through, because we don't know people's path. We don't know what they're going through. We have to have compassion. And so I try to have as much compassion as I can. And I particularly like the elderly because, okay, here's a secret. Every time I see an elderly person, I see my mother. And she's not with me here. She's not with me physically, but she's with me. She tells me when I'm doing something that I shouldn't be doing. But every time I see an elderly person, I see my mother in that person. And I see whatever physical ailments they're going through, I pray them away, much like I did with my own mother. In fact, I was in the Adoration Chapel one day and a lady walked in and I had to get up and hug her because she reminded me of my mother. She didn't look like my mother. She was a little redheaded lady.
Your mother was not a little redheaded lady.
No, she was not. And I said, her name is Frances. I have never seen that lady again. I said, do you mind if I hug you? She said, no, honey, just like my mother would have said. And I hugged her and I've never seen her again. So I have a special place in my heart for the elderly because number one, I see my mother in them. But number two, they need to know that we are joyful to be around them. They need to know that, yes, they have some physical restrictions that we don't have, but it's okay. It's okay because none of us are perfect. So I have a special place in my heart for the elderly. Actually, bad. I look for opportunities. So now when people hear this, they're going to run. But I look for opportunities to bring the message of Jesus to them because they need to know this is joy. This is a sunburst of joy. It's more joy than you can contain in your body. It's more joy than I can explain. And if I could explain it, it wouldn't be God, because God can't be defined by words. His joy cannot be defined by words. If he could be, he wouldn't be God. He wouldn't be a supreme being. Am I happy now? Yes. Am I scared? Yes. Because now you know all my secrets.
Oh, I don't think I know all of them. I think you got more for me.
I don't know.
I love hearing about your mom.
Yeah.
And also because you have children.
One in the 50s, one in the 40s, and one in the 30s. I took care of all
that. That's remarkable.
Yeah.
Impressive. And isn't it a beautiful thing that you're still talking about your mother? Oh, that's so sweet. And you're talking about hugging a woman because her entering the Adoration Chapel brought a little piece of your mom in there that you long for.
Yeah.
Otherwise, you wouldn't have felt compelled to go ask her for a hug.
No. And she would be the one to be in the Adoration Chapel. She wasn't the type to say, go in the Adoration Chapel. But her example and her joy when she came out, or her joy just to be around her, would make me want to know what was she doing so that I could have her joy. And it was her close relationship with God, her love for Mary. And when you're younger, you don't understand. I didn't understand. But once I started opening up my eyes to where her joy was coming from, I went, wow. This is nice. And then you want everybody else to have it. That's the thing. Once you are so full with joy, you can't contain yourself. You have to give it to someone else. It's too much for you to have inside of you. You have to share it with everyone you meet. And if they don't appear to receive it by your eyes, you just have to know that they have seen something good that day. And maybe they'll remember and come back to the joy or want the joy that we all have in knowing God and knowing Jesus.
Gosh, I just love this. Because as much time that I've spent with you before, I didn't know about your mom. And it
it's
makes
my secret.
Another secret. It's so beautiful, though, because it shows how well-loved you've been and how she shared with you the greatest gift, the gift of true joy, of complete joy, the gift of God, the gift of Christ. And now that's what you do. You followed her modeling. That's so beautiful.
When she passed away, the night before she passed away, I said, "Are you worried about me?" And she said, "No." I said, "Don't. Even if you start to worry a little bit, because you've left me a very rich woman, because I have your spirit. I have what you have. And no one is more wealthy than I am because of you." And she just turned around like, "Okay, I've done my job." And as I was walking out the door, I turned around to look at her, and she was giving me her blessing. And I didn't know what it meant. We knew she only had 2 weeks to live, and she passed away that night. I went home, and I had the best sleep I've ever had, and she passed away in the night. It was very beautiful, but if I could boast of any joy, it's her joy. And her joy, of course, was from Jesus. In fact, there's a lady at church. When she sees me, she cries. And my mom's been dead 10 years. She said, "Loved your mom." She was a nurse. And my mom broke her hip and she was in rehab. "Your mom was the best." She said she was the best patient I've ever had.
That's so touching.
It was very touching.
Well, and it's endearing and moving to hear that here she is, she had a broken hip and she needs all this help, yet she's sharing all this joy. And then she's a patient and the best patient that this nurse had ever had. But it goes to show that it's our being that's the gift, and it's our being that touches other people. It's not what we do. It doesn't have to do with accomplishments or anything else. It has to do with just the gift of joy, the gift of presence, the gift of love. And your mom emanated that. And to think about her, the last thing she did, if I'm not mistaken, is she blessed you.
And I turned around, and she probably didn't want to maybe alarm me. Because when I would leave, I would get to the door and she would call me back. And this night she didn't. And I turned around and said, "Oh, she's not calling me." And I saw her giving me the blessing. But I had just told her not to worry about me because she left me a very rich woman, very wealthy. I have all of your spirituality. And I was crying and she didn't say anything.
Thank you for sharing all of this, Shelia. And I will always remember that your mother gave you a blessing. That is so touching.
I know. It was very touching. And I just accepted it. I didn't go back and hug her. I just turned around. And probably God protects us. If I had gone back to hug her, it might not have been the same. I may have sprawled all over the bed, "Don't go." But I just turned around, accepted it, and then I left. And that was the last time I saw her.
Do you know what is striking me so deeply right now? And this is so the Holy Spirit, is that first you shared, hopefully I can articulate this. I'm crying more than Shelia is. First, you shared about the birth of your son and the peace and that intimacy and that closeness. And now you have shared about the death of your mother, both in a hospital room, and saying goodbye to your mom and her blessing you and peace.
And I was at peace when she did it. I was at peace. And I remember saying to her, "I'm so wealthy." And she knew. It's like she turned around, took a deep breath. It's like her job was done.
Her fiat, her yes to God was complete, and it was time for her to go home.
It was time for her. And I'm the only girl. I have 3 brothers. So her waiting for her girl paid off, I guess.
Yes. Yeah. So, Shelia, after losing a dear friend a little over a year ago, that really brought to life for me the idea of waiting in joyful hope to being reunited. I hope, Shelia, after my time on this earth is complete, not only with her, but with other loved ones and with loved ones that I'm on the earth with right now. And sometimes I'll imagine what it would be like if she would walk in a room or walk through the door. And I just think of the joy and the yelping. I mean, just the joyful noises and the jumping and the goodness that would come. Do you ever think of being reunited with your
all
mom?
All the time. I actually think my mom follows me. Because when I do something, okay, I got it. In fact, I use that Catholic guilt on my brothers. Okay, if they say something, would your mom want you to do that? Would our mom? Okay, okay. For a long time, now you're really going to think I'm crazy. I used to have a seat next to me in church. I would savor a seat and I'd put my purse there so nobody else would sit. And so that was her seat. She would sit next to me in church. Sometimes I still do it. Oh, you should be here, Mom. So sit here. She's with me. I know that I'm going to see her again face to face. But I know she's with me guiding the things that I should be doing or the things that I am doing. And I know that this evolving Mary gift is from her. I know it's from her because I just feel it. I just know it's from her. And my love for the elderly, she left her picks and her births just to take communion to the elderly. And she said to me, oh, I feel sorry for those old people. She was in her 80s doing this, and she feels sorry for the old people. But I picked it up and I said, what am I going to do with this? I can't give it away. And what am I going to do with these rosaries, these huge rosaries, this huge brown rosary that looks like the one the nuns carry on the way? What am I going to do with this? I can't give this away. So I use it all the time. I'm sure that's why my devotion to Mary has expanded, because of her, what she left, and this is what she wanted me to do. I'm a rich woman. I really, truly am, because I have, number one, her love in heaven interceding for me, and number two, all of the little physical possessions that she had here.
Thank you, Shelia. It's so beautiful. In closing, anything else that you'd want to share with listeners just to encourage them to live in joy-filled hope?
Stay in the present. Be sensitive to other people. Don't be so caught up in yourself. Don't be so caught up in your devices. And it's unfair to just use devices. Just don't be so caught up in where you're going and be where you are. Stay in the present. And be in the present with everyone you see. And it'll make your life happier. You'll be so surprised how much joy you will have.
Thank you, Shelia. You are such a gift of joy. Thank you so much for being with us.
Now you know all my secrets.
I think there's more still.
There is.
And thank you to everyone for being here today. I would love for you to take a moment to share Mamas in Spirit with others who you love and share the beautiful gift of the Holy Spirit and these testimonies of faith and these beautiful living witnesses like Shelia, and to take a moment to review, like, and subscribe to Mamas in Spirit. And Shelia, would you close us in prayer?
Heavenly Father, I thank you so much for this privilege of being here and sharing your message. I brought, hopefully, the kingdom of God to this podcast. And I thank you so much for giving me the mother you gave me, you so designed for me. Thank you, Lord. Thank you for people like Lindy who share the word, your word, through this podcast. And that means that's more than the people she meets. It's the people she meets who meets and meets and meets. Thank you, Lord. Amen.
Amen. Please know that you can reach out anytime and that we are praying for you. And let us pray for one another as a Mamas in Spirit community during this time of Advent, and that we can all wait more fully in joy-filled hope. This is Lindy Nguyen with Mamas in Spirit. May God bless you and yours always.